Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This time I'll ask Mr. Boswell to give an invocation, please.
Be glad to. Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this, all the things you have given this country. Thank you for everything you've given us this past week with the rain. Farmers needed that so badly. Dear Heavenly Father, be with us tonight as we go through and discuss the county's business. Help us out to figure out what we need to do and help us make wise decisions. And dear Heavenly Father, be with our troops as they're overseas fighting the war. Protect them and protect any of our citizens that are traveling overseas. Look after them. And dear Heavenly Father, these things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, the first thing on our agenda is a discussion of the decorum that we have for public input and also for commissioners' comments. Because we've had some issues during the public comments, the public comments are not for debate. I just want everybody to know that. They are what they say, public comments. And I've talked to most of the municipalities in the county, and no one else lets anybody have a response to their public comments. It's strictly for public comments. However, during our commissioner comments, they may respond to the public comments. And I want everybody to know that, too. And per request to the county manager, we have some suggestions on guidelines, because I think we need some guidelines for the public input session as well as for the county commissioners. Now, we're not going to vote on these tonight, but we do have copies of them up here. And so I want us to look at those, and next week we'll discuss them. And if it's some, I don't want all of them. I don't like all of it. And I'm sure y'all won't either after you read it. So, and then next week we'll discuss it and take change or make changes or whatever, if that's all right with the board. Is that all right with the board? Okay, but at this point, that's what I would like to see happen. And at this time, I will ask for commissioners' comments on this situation since we are on the agenda.
Right. I'd like to say you claim that nobody allows a comment in rebuttal. But I talked to two counties back to back, and they said their county commissioners, there was no way that you could get them not to respond to something they felt like they needed to respond to. And I would just say to the chair that, with all due respect, I did apologize for my raising of my voice the other week. And I would have thought that would have sufficed, considering that I have sat here for so long and have never done that before, except with the people that have come before us, namely Fairness Alamance people. And I have to just be honest and say that when somebody mentions my name and a factual distortion or a misconception, or say that I have said something that I haven't said, I'm not going to wait 1 hour to give a response to that person, because it's out of context. That person could very well be gone, and the emotion of the moment would have escaped us, possibly. So with all due respect, I do know I need to tone it down a little bit, but I'm very passionate about what I believe in, especially about what I've been outspoken about with the people here before, namely, mainly all Fairness Alamance people. But again, I have to respond when I have that open opportunity, and nobody can forbid me to do so. And I don't think any rules that we make would supersede our rights to have a fair democratic exchange. But I'm glad that we do have some policies here, because the policies that I got from Randolph, Davidson, I believe Anson County, there's four counties involved, they all have similar rules. For instance, people who speak here before us aren't supposed to talk about commissioners. They're not supposed to talk about elections. They're not supposed to talk about supposed possible litigation or litigation that we're involved in. And frankly, I think that's a good idea. But to think that somebody should have to wait an hour and a half to respond to a factual distortion, I can't do that.
Well, I've got all of mine from Alamance County. This is all the municipalities in Alamance County that abide by that guideline, that there will be no response to.
Did you call any counties?
I did not call any other counties.
Well, this is county government.
Because this is Alamance County.
Municipal governments tend to be a little more liberal and a little more bureaucratic. But the counties I called said, there's no way you're going to keep our commissioners from responding to something that is very flagrant that they want to respond to that moment. And there's no law that says that they have to be quiet for an hour and a half before they can respond.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody else?
Well, in discussing that, Tim, did you ask any of the counties if they held them at the first or last of the meeting?
Everybody seems to hold it at the first.
At the first. I didn't know if that was a protocol that's been
handled. Now, you did mention something, you know, tonight to me, you know, and if you want to comment on that about having the comments at the end, which would be close
right.
to us.
And that way it gives
yeah.
us time to listen to everybody. Then we would have a time to respond back to their comments
right.
instead of having the verbal debate throughout,
right.
you know.
And
I
it
could,
used to be
it.
That way.
Okay.
Yeah, I could buy
it. It used to be that way.
Maybe we can do that and talk about
well,
it.
Well, next week we'll.
That'd be good.
We can talk about it.
Yeah, we can talk
I'm,
about
I'm
it.
I'm willing.
Yeah.
I'm willing.
Just, we want to read that stuff. Okay, Bill, Ann?
Fine.
Bill? No comments here? Okay, so do we have a consensus that we will just put this on for next week?
Sure.
Good.
After we read this, and then we'll discuss
okay.
that next week.
Yep.
Okay.
No, I was just saying we'll get other copies as well. And if Commissioner Sutton, if I could get those copies that you have, I'll
yeah,
give those
right
to the
now.
Board also.
Okay.
See, I could have somebody run me down here, and then I might die before I get a chance to comment. So.
I could comment today.
We won't comment.
We won't comment. Okay, next on our
well, agenda.
Next on our agenda is public comments. And Vanessa Jennings, is that it? Okay.
I believe that's all I have.
Good evening, Madam
Good
Chair,
evening.
Commissioners. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Consumer Family Advocacy Committee, also known as CFAT, which is a state-mandated committee that's part of the LME. Our mission is to make sure that persons that live within our community that have a mental illness, a developmental disability, or a substance abuse problem receives the treatment that they need. We're aware of the fact that the LME will be merging with a yet undetermined LME in the near future. And our request to you tonight is to make sure that our community continues to have the services needed by the aforementioned individuals available locally prior to signing any agreement with anyone. We're asking that you please seek input from people within the community that know the needs of the community, because every community is different. Please try to see the big picture rather than just individual pieces of the puzzle. To cut cost without having the proper services in place will only increase the cost in the future. If individuals do not have access to readily available crisis services, medications, there's going to be an increase in police calls. There's going to be an increased number of people going to the emergency room. There's going to be increased rehospitalization for these people. According to the latest report, critical measures at a glance for the state fiscal year 2010 fourth quarter report for LME performance, the two LMEs that are currently being considered have a lower lab percentage of timely access to care in both emergent and urgent care. This is a great concern for the CFAT committee. We need to make sure that the individuals in this community continue to receive the same level of services they're currently receiving or higher. And I appreciate you listening to me.
Thank you. And I did forget to say you have everybody has 3 minutes, but you did not make your three
also mentioned Linda that to state their name. I mean,
yeah,
we don't know everybody.
Right, right.
And if it's on the bottom, they need to say their name or at the top one, but they don't read on that. So next is David Blair.
Good evening. I am David Blair. How y'all loving this weather?
Right.
I tell you, this is the best in North Carolina. In his correspondence with the Department of Justice, as well as in the September 20th meeting of this board, County Attorney Albright made a point worthy of further exploration. Noting that the sheriff is a state-elected official, he asserted, and I believe Commissioner Lashley agreed, that the Alamance County Commissioners cannot direct the sheriff's activities. This is true, as far as it goes. The problem is, it doesn't go nearly far enough. While the Alamance County Commissioners do not have the power to tell the sheriff what to do, they do have the power to direct the activities of the county attorney. You can tell the county attorney in detail how to respond to this investigation. You can direct him, for example, to rescind his July 26 letter requesting the deputies not speak to investigators unless he is present. You can direct him to allow the ride-alongs that the investigators believe are critical to their inquiry. You can tell him to supply all documents and materials requested by the DOJ on or before a date certain. And having so directed the county attorney, you can tell the sheriff, this is how the county attorney will respond, should you choose to use him as a resource. Further, as you control the sheriff's budget, you can tell him that any and all costs resulting from this investigation will be borne by his department alone, with no taxes raised nor any other department's budget reduced in support of his defense. And you can use your control of the sheriff's budget to encourage quick and complete compliance. You can, for example, amend the sheriff's budget by any amount you deem appropriate, 10%, 20%, any amount, laying those funds aside until the DOJ investigators inform you that they are fully satisfied with the sheriff's cooperation and compliance. In so doing, you would be offering the sheriff a clear choice between protecting the people of Alamance County and protecting himself from whatever he fears this investigation might uncover. In short, you do not have to remain helpless spectators to this investigation. You can take action to ensure that it is quickly and properly completed. As there is absolutely no harm that can accrue to this county from this investigation, and there may be ongoing harm from any activities by the sheriff that deprive individuals of their civil rights, as well as even greater harm to the county from any civil suits or criminal prosecutions that may result from such deprivations, I urge you once again to use the tools at your disposal to ensure quick, full, and complete compliance with this investigation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next is Mike Kelly.
Hi, Commissioners. Mike Kelly. That's going to be a tough act to follow. I didn't know we had a commissioner at large. I'll get right to my reason for being here tonight, and pardon me if I speed read to make this 3-minute deadline. I've invested a great deal of time in research at Fairness Alamance, their members, their friends, and associates. What I learned is disturbing, and most of it is right out in the open for everyone to see that cares to study their activities. While there is a local following of average citizens, the organization is built around a nucleus of educated and motivated professionals. Civil rights activism is little more than a smokescreen for these people, which gives them a public platform in which to operate and solicit support from the unsuspecting and kind folk among our community. Allow me to quote Dr. Roselle from her 2006 book, Media and the Politics of Failure. Many scholars have noted that political ideology and governmental structure significantly affect political communication. In other words, democratic and authoritarian systems, media, are structured quite differently and have different purposes in a democracy. The media are seen as an independent watchdog, the fourth estate, acting as a protection against unrestrained power. In the authoritarian system, media are depicted as a mouthpiece to disseminate the leadership's propaganda, end quote. I submit that Dr. Roselle not only has the capacity to understand and express the governmental relationships with media, but also to turn the paradigm on its head and reconstruct the media relationship for her own purposes. There are also, of course, academic relationships that give her access to powerful people and organizations from which the common man is far removed. Academic careers also lend themselves favorably to molding the thinking of successive waves of voters, and conservatism is not on the curriculum guide. Do not underestimate the power these people wield within and without the classrooms. Working in unison with other academics, political figures, foreign consultants, attorneys with mutual interests, business behavioral consultants, and marketing strategists, it would be child's play to overcome simple local governmental structures and replace them with something and someone far more pliable and useful to their needs. Is this what's taking place here? As I understand it, Mr. Blair has already secured the seat at vice chair at the local Democratic Party. I say be forewarned that all is not as it seems. Commissioner Lashley had it more right than you know, and the true agenda of Fair and Salamance is not yet clear, thanks to extremely limited public scrutiny. Speaking of things public, I want to mention the 501c status that Mr. Blair alluded to some time ago. Research indicates that although local immigration attorney Eber Rossi filed articles of incorporation April 6, 2009, no Form 1023 appears to have been submitted to the IRS for review by either the IRS or the public. As that filing outlines the structures of the organization, identifies board members, accounts for receipts and expenditures, and defines the purpose and use of the organization, I would appreciate an opportunity to examine it. So would a lot of other taxpayers, and likely the county attorney. So please urge the Incorporator of Fair and Salamance, Inc. to provide the documents. It's our right under IRS rules and civil code to examine these.
Thank you. Your time is up, so I'm sorry. Bring it next time. Thanks, sir.
Point of order. It is, and I'm not going to make the motion, but it is possible that if we want to make a motion, let him continue, and we had a majority vote, he could do it. So just so that's understood.
Okay. Okay.
We got this point.
I just have to remind them that when they're 3 minutes.
I understand, ago. But I just want to make a point of order.
Okay. Next on here is Mr. Oaks, John Oaks.
Commissioners, good evening. John Oaks, Burlington, North Carolina. It's been presented as fact that this board and all government in the United States is subordinate to the federal government. The U.S. Constitution does state it is the supreme law of the land, and Thomas Jefferson said states and all governments under the great government are subordinate. Well, here's the complete story you haven't heard. Thomas Jefferson and our founders knew that the word subordinate means to be lower in power and authority. The word subordinate was not written in the Constitution to imply subordinate in all things. That was not the intention when it was written then, nor is it now. Jefferson and the other founders didn't create the Constitution suggesting that the federal government was supreme in all things. This ideology totally misrepresents the words written in the Constitution and skews its very purpose and understanding of what the Constitution was designed to prevent. Excuse me. The Founding Fathers did not imply or intend that the federal government be supreme in all things. This is a historical fact. I find it very difficult to believe that any reasonable and educated person about our country's history can even ponder this historical fact. So what would Thomas Jefferson say if he were here tonight in reference to the suggestion that our elected county officials have no standing to serve as a check and balance on the investigation into our elected Sheriff Johnson and his department by the federal government? Here's what Jefferson wrote in a letter in 1816 to Joseph Cabell. The way to have good and safe government is not to trust it all to one, but to divide it among the many, distributing to everyone exactly the function he is competent to. Let the national government be entrusted with the defense of the nation and its foreign and federal relations, the state governments with the civil rights, laws, police, and administration of what concerns the state generally, the counties with the local concerns of the counties, and each ward direct the interest within itself. It is by dividing and subdividing these republics from the great national one down through all its subordinations until it ends in the administration of every man's farm by himself, by placing everyone what his own eye may superintend, that all will be done for the best. Commissioners, respectfully, don't let your minds be confused and skewed by those that misinterpret or dilute the words in our Constitution, our Founding Fathers' purpose and intentions of our Constitution. If our Founding Fathers were here this evening, they would be aghast at the suggestion that you and this board are subordinate to the federal government in all things. If there is a disagreement between Sheriff Johnson and the Department of Justice, let them work it out. If it can't be resolved amicably, let the process proceed in litigation. No one wants that. But this is the system our founders created with when there are differences that need to be resolved by various levels of government. Support Sheriff Johnson, our county attorney, Mr. Albright, in their efforts in handling this investigation by the Department of Justice. It's not only the legal thing to do, it's the right thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rex. Kim Oliver.
Kim Oliver. Hello, Commissioners. I've truly enjoyed the meeting so far, as I hope you have. Unfortunately, now I have to ask a couple embarrassing questions. First, I've heard that Sheriff Hopeful Ron Parrish has made a statement that if he is elected, he will put 15 more uniformed officers on patrol. I'm curious is if that is possible without increasing the funding to the Sheriff's Department. And if it is, why has it not already been done? Of course, I am in no way, shape, or form suggesting that we must increase funding and raise taxes to increase the number of patrols. I just can't understand how such a thing hasn't already been done if it is possible. Secondly, I'm interested in knowing how a non-outsider, a now outsider, who has not been privy to the operations and cost structure of the Sheriff's Department for 2 years, would have enough information to make such an assessment. Is there a breach of security within the department that we should know about? Or are the financial records of the sheriff open to everyone? Maybe it was just one of those campaign promises that gets made during the election cycle and never gets realized, but I need your advice on this and I'm asking for it now. Last but certainly not least, I address this inquiry directly to Commissioner Vaughn. Commissioner, immediately following the last commissioner's meeting, a number of people in this room observed you being escorted to and seated at a table in a restaurant up the street by Mr. Ansbacher, where you apparently had a private discussion. Now, I took it in stride when you broke ranks with the other commissioners and failed to support the sheriff during the attacks by the ACLU and now the DOJ. I also took a deep breath and tried to dismiss the emails I received several weeks ago that was filled with photographs of you at a fundraiser for Mr. Parrish, where you appeared to have Finest Alamance members stuck to you like baked on enamel. I do not, however, think I can overlook your breaking bread with someone who just an hour before was attacking the entire board of with accusations and misconduct and claims of cover-up. Unless you were willfully subjecting yourself to one of Mr. Ansbacher's now infamous sniff tests on some personal level, it seems to me you were placing yourself on a trajectory towards favoritism and away from public service. Even if the meeting was a personal matter between you and Mr. Ansbacher, unrelated to the prior meeting, aren't you up for re-election and aware of how such an event could easily be interpreted? Would you please use your time during the commissioner's comment segment of tonight's meeting to explain the purpose of your sit-down with someone who has, by his own admission, been trying to steer political debate in this county for more years with private phone calls and meetings? In my opinion, you have done a disservice to the board, to the sheriff, and to the community. I hope there is an explanation that will satisfy my concerns. Others here are anxious to hear one as well. Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is with Mr. Daniel Osborne, if you'll come up, and this National 4-H Week Proclamation, and he is the Vice President of the 4-H County Council.
Thank you.
Hey, Daniel.
Hello. Good evening, Commissioners. Whereas the youth of any community are its greatest natural resource, and whereas 4-H is the largest youth organization in North Carolina with nearly one in every eight North Carolinian youth involved in 4-H. And whereas 4-H in North Carolina claims more than 200,000 youth members and 27,000 adult volunteers, while Alamance County's 4-H program numbers 1,394 youth and 92 volunteers. And whereas 4-H addresses issues facing youth wherever they live, in inner cities, suburbs, and rural communities, and helps break barriers by focusing on learning by doing. And whereas 4-H has programs on food, nutrition, science and technology, natural resources, substance abuse prevention, growing plants, caring for farm animals, career education, community pride, citizenship, and leadership. And whereas exciting, fun, and student-centered educational programs are available through county 4-H school enrichment programs. And whereas 4-H, as part of the North Carolina Cooperative Extension Service, is a program where youth learn together in all kinds of projects, events, and activities. Now therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim October 3rd through 9th, 2010 to be National 4-H Week in Alamance County, and urge the people of this county to take advantage of the opportunity to become more aware of the special program which gives youth the chance to learn together and be a part of Alamance County 4-H, and support the work of the 4-H Youth Development Program. Thank you.
We appreciate you coming. I'll make the motion.
I have a motion that we accept this proclamation.
Second.
And have a second. At this time, I've already signed this one. And I do go to the 4-H board, and I met this young man on several occasions, and he is a super nice young man. He has a sister, and they sing together. So you guys ought to hear them sing. They really do a good job. And so I appreciate you, Daniel.
Thank you.
And thank you so much. And I appreciate the 4-H. Okay, the next thing is... use of lottery funds. W.D. Yarber, Director of Facilities Construction for Alamance Burlington School System. Hello.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, I come tonight before y'all to request the funding of $2,450,000 for the Alamance Burlington School System for the building of two addition, four classroom additions. I'm here to answer whatever questions y'all have for me.
Where will they be built at?
Western Middle and AO.
Okay. Eight classrooms.
Total, yes, ma'am.
How many have we built to date, not counting those, with the lottery funds?
With lottery funds, we built the one at Sylvan, four classrooms at Sylvan. We built B. Jordan, six classrooms with lottery funds.
So this would be 18 classrooms.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's great.
What funds were used to build the extra classrooms at the high schools several years ago?
That was with the bond money, the back in the 2000, whatever, the $36 million bond fund.
So the elementary school and middle schools are just catching up.
Madam Chair, just to let you know, once we,
if you approve of this, this will still leave a balance in our bond funds of about $4 million. Once we get the allocation in for this year, and then we were getting $1 million from it to balance off our budget. That was the deal we worked out with the school board. There still will be a $4 million balance in the lottery fund.
Okay. You got here a motion that we accept this.
So moved.
Have a second. Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is community correction. Corrections, probation, and parole modular project. Mr. Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. As a follow-up to your September the 7th meeting, we do have before you two items that we're requesting approval tonight. At that meeting, you did instruct the staff to negotiate a contract with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King for a contract for design work, site preparation, and construction administration for the probation and paroles modular unit. So we have that contract before you tonight. Prior to approving that, we would ask that you adopt a resolution exempting Alamance County from provisions of General Statute 143-64.31 as provided for in General Statute 143-64.32. And what that basically is, that the normal process when you're looking at engineering and architectural contracts is that when you go out and solicit bids for those, you solicit based on qualifications, not based on costs for the design services. Once you choose your architect or engineer, then you work through a negotiation process of determining a fee for their services. We had Allie Williams, Carmen, and King go ahead and work on the site analysis portion of this, so we wanted to, for the board, to exempt us from having to go through the process of soliciting proposals from architect and engineering firms, because we would like for them to continue the previous work they've been doing as it gets into the design phase and the site preparation and construction administration. So we're asking you first to adopt that resolution, which will exempt us from those provisions.
What's that going to do to the cost? It's going to run the cost up, in my opinion. If we don't take bids, it's going to run the cost of this project up.
Well, the normal way that you would do it is you would actually not... The normal way that you bid construction, architecture and engineering contracts, is you do not solicit based on prices. What you solicit is based on qualifications. Then once you choose the architect or engineer based on qualifications, then you sit and negotiate a price with them. What we've done is basically foregone the process of having different firms submit on qualifications because we feel like this firm is qualified. And so then we've gone to the second step of working out a contract with them. So if we were to go through a bidding process, we would not be bidding on price. We would be bidding on qualifications. We feel like they have the qualifications, so we want to forego that step. And then we have gone through the process of working a contract out with them. So I don't know if it would have any bearing.
I definitely think they're qualified.
Yes, sir. And so I don't know that that would have a bearing on the cost.
And they're a local company.
Yes, sir.
That's a definite plus.
Could I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
This 10,000 square feet office building, if this is a modular and you order a modular, don't they do the specifications and don't they do the architectural type stuff? Don't they call the county or the municipality, wherever it's going to be, to find out the specs that they need to follow? In other words, I'm getting to, do we need an architectural firm at a cost of probably $800,000, the best I could figure?
Yeah. Well,
we could do this much cheaper.
Right, that's a very
or hire a local contractor or find one of these buildings that are already out there that are not being used and refurbish it.
Right. Very good question. The first part of their fee, their total fee for this would be an estimate would be $83,360. That's the total fee. The first part of it is site engineering work to get the site ready for, to be able to place a modular on it, plus to be able to do the parking lot, both the asphalt part and the gravel. So, and they've got some facilities that we've actually got to demolish that are on the site now. So the first part of the fee is $28,000 for site engineering. In regards to the building itself, the building design is $29,000. What they'll actually be doing is they will be meeting with probation and parole staff to determine what their needs as far as office space goes. So they'll go through a process of determining what the actual needs are of probation and paroles. Then they will, what they'll be designing really is more of a floor plan for this facility based on their meetings with probation and paroles to determine what their needs are. Now, once they take that floor plan, then they'll actually put it in a bid package to go out to multiple modular companies, and the modular companies will be responsible for doing your engineered sealed drawings for electrical, plumbing, mechanical, all of that stuff. So they will not actually be handling that. If they had to do all of that, they would be charging us more than what they're proposed to charge us in here, because their building design is limited on trying to determine what space is needed, plus doing a floor plan, plus handling the bidding process. So they won't be handling the design of the electrical, plumbing, and mechanical work. That'll be done actually by the modular company. That's a good question.
Do we know what the actual cost of all this is going to be?
The
ballpark figure?
Right. Based on the past meeting, the total cost of the whole project, we're looking at the estimate they had at the last meeting was $1,320,000.
Are you tearing down some buildings with this?
Yes, sir.
I mean,
six or eight, somewhere in there. I've got it in the...
See, I called about the same question about the total dollars there, and that's what I found out was part of the cost.
I think there's eight plus one item's got, one building's got to be moved, but so there's eight.
That includes buildings. Removal, debris, and all that.
I'm sorry, 10 buildings will have to be demolished on site, yes.
That includes everything, removal and everything.
That's correct.
Okay. No hidden cost.
Also, Tim, I may ask Darrell if it's okay. You would do the design layout of the footings for the modulars. You'll have to do those, right?
It's really
going to
be about three bid packages. Demolition will be bid, then the site work will be bid, then the modular will be bid. So it's
and you'll handle all those bids all as they come in.
Yes.
And what do you? How are we going to pay for this, Tim?
Right now we're the space that we're leasing for probation and paroles, right now we're paying $137,847.60 in lease payments for the two different probation and parole offices that we have in Alamance County.
Repeat that figure.
It's $137,847.60. That's what really prompted this, because before we were paying approximately half of that, the state changed their rules and required the county to bear the entire almost the entire cost. I think they do pay some based on if there's a director that is over a certain district, then they actually pay some of their office space. But for the most part, we're incurring all the costs for lease.
Okay, and this is a year.
That's a year. So what we're going to do is we will take part of that and use it on the debt payment, and the other part of it we'll use for utilities. So depending on the total cost of this project depends on how long the loan will be, but what we're planning on doing is using the lease payments to actually make the debt service payment. So at some point in the future, all of this will be paid off, and at that point, we will not have the recurring cost of what now is lease payments in our budget. We will not have that at some point down the road. Not sure how far that is. We'll have to wait till we actually get actual cost, plus to see what the terms of the loan are and all of that, which will be brought to you at a future meeting.
Yeah, because I would really like to see a ceiling put on this project, not to exceed what we would be paying in rent.
Well, you can do that, and basically what you would do you would be going out as far as you could with your loan, whether it's 10, 12, 15, but the bank's only going to let us go out so far, so that's something we've got to work out also.
So if it goes over, what do we do?
Well, we'll look at, can our budget absorb some of this cost? Maybe so. We'll just have to at that time look and see, whether it can absorb some of it so that we can pay the debt service off quicker. That may be one option, so that we don't extend the loan out too long as far as have it too many years down the road. If we'd like to have a shorter repayment period, then we could see if our budget could absorb some of the cost that the lease payments, what we have lease payments now, may not cover the debt service. So those are some options we can look at.
Any more questions? Not, do I hear a motion we accept this resolution?
So moved.
I have a motion, a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, no. Okay, and then the approval of the contract. I'll go ahead and do that.
Yeah, and there's basically, real quickly, the fees on that. Site engineering is a lump sum of $28,000. The building design is a lump sum fee of $29,000. And construction administration is based on an hourly rate, and the estimate on that is $26,360. So we're estimating the total cost of their fees would be $83,360.
Okay. Any questions about that? Not. Do I hear a motion that we accept the contract as well?
I'll make a motion.
Have a motion?
Second.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Likewise?
Okay. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Darrell, for the hard work y'all already done.
Thank you. The next thing is Jason Martin. There you are, Jason. Proposed Jordan Lake Rules Buffer Ordinance Amendment.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me regarding the riparian buffer requirements for the Jordan Lake rules. You probably will recall that back in the spring, the Planning Board made a recommendation to amend the watershed ordinance to include the Jordan Lake requirements for riparian buffers. As opposed to, there was a model ordinance that the state had issued that was roughly 44 pages long that dealt with the buffer requirements. And so the Planning Board made that recommendation, and you all recommended as well that we go ahead and send that to the state. On September 9th, we were rejected by the Environmental Management Commission, the amendments that were proposed. So in response, I prepared another proposal to deal with the requirements. Basically, what you have here are two sections of the watershed ordinance that would be amended, as opposed to including all of this other language into the ordinance. Section 102, exceptions to applicability, we would add a subsection E that would state, exceptions listed in this section shall not apply to the requirement of riparian buffers as set forth in section 204 of this ordinance. Within that deals with existing, basically it says that the exceptions to applicability go with existing development and things like that, which discussing with the state, we have always required to enforce those buffer requirements in the watershed areas, even when there was existing development, because it's also part of the subdivision ordinance as well. So there's really no change by putting that. It's more adding that language for the state's peace of mind, I guess. And then section 204 under stream buffers, we would change the title of this section to the following Section 204 stream and pond buffers. Delete all existing text within Section 204 and replace it with the following text. Quote, the riparian buffer protection rules of 15A NCAC 02B .0267 and .0268 and Section 6G of Session Law 2009-216 found in Section 7B of Session Law 2009-484, Jordan Water Supply Nutrient Strategy apply to all lands regulated by this ordinance. Basically, in layman's terms, what that is saying is that we will follow state law. We will follow what the session law was that was passed, which is, again, still the same thing. The same things that are exempt would still be the case. Farming would still be exempt under the watershed ordinance. This would apply solely to those water supply watershed areas that we currently enforce. The other areas of the Jordan watershed would be the state's responsibility to enforce. That is basically what this proposal is saying. It's in a roundabout way the same thing as before, just a little bit cleaner. This is actually something that was done by another county. It was done by Wake County. Made this amendment. They got the attorneys at DWQ to say they were okay with it. And so their proposal was approved, is my understanding. So, and I feel like we should be able to get this approved as well. It is still subject to review of the Environmental Management Commission. They'll have 90 days after we submit this to them to review it and to get back any feedback to the county. And if they reject it or want clarification, we would have, again, 60 days to respond to them. The Alamance County Planning Board has reviewed the proposal. And they did vote unanimously at their September 9th meeting to recommend presenting these proposed amendments to the state. If it is the will of the board to do that tonight, I will send these along to the Division of Water Quality. And I'll be glad to take any questions you all have.
Let me ask the question for Clyde. If we do not pass this, basically what we're agreeing to, if we pass this, is we're agreeing to the rules and regulations of the state. If the county doesn't go along with this, do we have to enforce it?
We have to enforce the state law. There's no choice.
Okay.
It was a lot of discussion with the planning board as to, okay, let's do not do this, let's do not do this, but the thing is, the state is mandated.
That's right. State law, we're responsible for abide by state law.
Thank you, Raleigh, for what you did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Madam Chair, if I may, I wanted to just also add, there was a great deal of concern at the meeting back in, I think it was in March, regarding, and it was a big concern of the planning boards as well, regarding civil penalties that would go with this, because in the model ordinance, they were astronomical, or $10,000 or $25,000. I have been told that is not something that we have to adopt. We can continue to enforce under our civil penalties under the watershed ordinance, which is, $500 per day. So it's much more reasonable. And also, I apologize, Ken Walker, our planning board chairman, phoned me today and informed me he had fallen ill and was not going to be able to be here tonight. But he definitely did want to reiterate that the planning board, one of their big issues that they wanted was to make it clear that they did not want to adopt another ordinance. And Mr. Boswell, you can kind of elaborate.
Well, and that's basically what they were saying is, you know, we didn't want to do this as a planning board. They did, the board didn't. But Jason had to recommend that we do because of the state regulation. And I mean, we could send it back and forth a little bit more and prolong it, but there really isn't any choice. As Clyde said, just, they're going to come down and enforce it. So.
Okay. Any more questions?
What other counties have been rejected by the?
I'm not sure about counties. I think Rockingham was initially rejected, and actually Rockingham was going to do more restrictive. They were going to go completely undisturbed, 50-foot buffers on perennial and intermittent streams. I think they did eventually get approved, but I'm honestly, sir, I'm not sure which counties were rejected. I've been told there were roughly four or five communities that were. There were less on this.
Home builders was represented, farmers, and everybody on this.
It is. It it's pretty restrictive what they've done to some. I mean, it's just like one of the people on the planning board does septic tanks, and sometimes you have to cross streams, and you know there's some issues there that he may have to figure out how to deal with. But
and that in the original proposal, that was actually something that we changed, and it, and the state specifically came back and said, no, this has to come out.
Right.
They found all your changes, Jason.
They are thorough.
Yeah. I think Jason did do a good job trying to respond and get the least restrictive rules we can get in here.
Okay. Do I hear a motion that we accept this proposed local ordinance amendment?
So moved.
Have a motion.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay.
Should we do it under duress?
Okay. Right. Just give credit where credit's due.
Madam Chair, if I may just add one more thing on that. This is not actually, the ordinance is not amended tonight.
Oh, okay.
Even if we still have to have approval from the EMC, and then we will have to do a public hearing to
oh,
actually
okay.
amend
okay.
the ordinance.
Okay.
We'll so.
Is there still a debate in Raleigh as to who owns the water on a farm? And I guess that might sound vague, but I vaguely remember there was some bills in Raleigh. They were trying to push that they that a farmer or somebody just you know had land, a lot of land, didn't necessarily own the water that was on their property and their well or whatever. Are you familiar with this at all, Clyde?
I read an article in the paper, and that's what it was saying, that that was the case. But you know, I don't know if there's anything legal makes it that way.
And that's the resource we're going to run out of first. I wouldn't be surprised if we do what the western states have done and claim state ownership of water.
I think that's a good idea.
Well, yeah, once Raleigh gets to be the next Atlanta, which is what they're trying to do, that's right. That's exactly what they're going to do, is try to get our water.
Mm-hmm.
That we've paid good infrastructure to have.
Is that all? Any more questions? Okay. We'll do that next when you get that ready. Set public hearing for scattered sites. Community Development Block Grant, Mr. Martin.
Okay. And also in your package, you should have a memorandum from me regarding setting a public hearing for the Scattered Site Housing Community Development Block Grant application. Every 3 years, the county is eligible to receive Scattered Site Housing grant monies. And this is, again, done to provide housing rehabilitation and relocation assistance to owner-occupied single-family homes for low to moderate-income persons in Alamance County. We can do repair houses anywhere within the county's jurisdiction, just not within the city of Burlington. A public hearing is required before we can submit an application to the state, and staff's recommending that we set a public hearing for October 18th at 7 p.m.
Any questions on that?
There's a form that night, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I think with Orange County is no.
Well,
November 29th.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's a public form.
It is, but that's our meeting night too. That's where we're changing it.
Times News. You know anything about this?
It is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's.
I'm sorry.
It is on the 18th. Yep.
Yeah.
It is.
But did y'all check into that before you said it? No offense. I mean, you know, those are things you got to check into. I mean, you know, I can't be two places at one time.
Well, and that's the candidates for them, I think.
Yeah.
It is, but it's not the commissioners.
Yeah, I didn't.
It is not the commissioners.
I think you're right.
Ours
20th is the commissioners.
Yeah, okay. Okay. I apologize.
So it's not a
commissioner. I knew that it was one, but I don't know.
Something on it. Okay.
I think it's the sheriff's department.
I think the sheriff is
right.
Debating that night.
Okay.
Yeah, whatever.
I'm going to get you on the 20th.
Yes, sir.
Warm up on the 18th, right?
No, we'll wait to respond to Kim's remarks and then.
Okay.
I can tell you where to go
so
with
do
it.
I hear a motion that we.
You probably will.
No, I don't mean
that. I'll make the motion.
Okay, have a motion to set the
second
for October 18th. All in
favor?
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay, next is Sherry Hook. This is a personnel committee recommendation for reduction in force.
Commissioners. Well, it's a little bit misleading. It's actually for transfer of benefits policy.
Oh, okay.
Due to the impending reduction of force for Alamance County LME employees, Alamance County would like to encourage current LME employees to seek employment with Alamance County. Now, this would be for current vacant positions. We're not creating any new positions. Although LME employees would not receive any special considerations during the hiring process, We'd like to provide special considerations for them regarding transfer of benefits if they were to come to work for Alamance County. Mainly, we'd like to give them service credit as it relates to retiree health insurance eligibility. And the reason that we're looking at that is because they are currently participating in the Alamance County health care plan. So if they came to work with us, we'd hate for them to start over as a new employee.
Exactly.
So if you'll look on the memo that I sent, basically we're only talking about giving them credit as it relates to retiree health insurance eligibility, and then also we would accept any sick leave balances that they currently have at LME. The benefits that we're not going to be looking at transferring or offering would be longevity pay, vacation accrual, service awards, waiver of the 12-month waiting period for FMLA entitlement, and then the vacation balances would not be transferred to Alamance County government. So basically, we would be treating them as new employees, except where it comes to their retirement health insurance eligibility. So the Personnel Committee has met and talked about this, and that is the recommendation of the Personnel Committee.
Who's on your Personnel Committee?
It is Commissioner Vaughn, the County Manager. Amy Weaver is on there. Tim Burgess is on there. I'm on there. Joanne Taylor sits on it as well from my office.
I think we need to change that where the commissioners have more say-so in those personnel committees than the people who are going to benefit from these things. I think we need to change that. We need to change the makeup of that committee where the representatives are more commissioners than employees.
It used to be the personnel committee was made up of HR director, one commissioner, and the county manager.
That's the way it should be.
That's the way it has been. Had been.
We got too many employees that stand to gain something by being on that committee. I'm going to make a motion that we table this, and the commissioners maybe have a chance to look at this makeup of this committee.
I got a question before we do.
Okay.
If you don't mind.
I don't mind.
Let everybody before you make a motion.
Okay.
Okay. On longevity pay, I know a lot of places, if they work for so long, that they can bill that back. So are we not going to ever allow them to use their longevity pay for working for mental health?
Well, the longevity pay, the way that we recognize it, is continuous service with Alamance County government. And so the only way that an employee could build back time is if they had worked for Alamance County government, left, and then came back to Alamance County. And what we say is that they have to be with us 5 years the second time around for us to go back and recognize any of that prior credit. So we haven't been doing that for employees that transfer in from other counties or municipalities, and we weren't planning on doing that for LME employees.
Okay. And vacation accrual, they should get paid for that. From the mental health.
For mental health, they should get paid out
exactly.
The vacation balance,
exactly.
And then they'd come in as new employees earning at the new employee rate.
Okay. That's all I have to ask about. Anybody else got any questions? Okay, and then.
No, but I will follow up with this on commissioner's conference, please.
And I have a motion on the floor, if you would please say that again.
I'm going to make the motion that we table this until the commissioners have the chance to look at this makeup of this committee.
Okay. I have a motion on the floor to table this subject.
I'll second that.
I have a second on that. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay. This will be tabled to the next meeting. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. The next thing is the budget. Ooh, I think we're into the budget amendments for the Emergency Telephone System Fund.
Good evening.
Hi there. How are you?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, how are you tonight?
Good.
Good. I stand before you this evening to request the use of $40,000 of the Alamance County 911 fund balance for the use of equipping the ambulances with AVL, which is automatic vehicle location, and the MCTs, which is mobile computer technology. This is also in accordance with House Bill 1691, which was signed by the governor as of 7/23 of this year, that the county could use these funds for purposes that you normally couldn't use 911 funding for. Also, this is bringing in, this also brings completion to a vision that we had in 2007 for equipping the ambulances with ABL and MCTs. And I think that this will really be good for the county because this allows us to track the ambulances, and also while tracking ambulances, it allows the telecommunicators downstairs to send information and data to the ambulances while they're en route to the calls. Okay. So I ask tonight that you allow us to use $40,000 of that funding.
Now,
that's a good move.
Yeah, will this link any to the hospitals and the transportation?
No, sir. What it does, it allows the ambulances to talk directly to the telecommunicators downstairs. And what the telecommunicators see on their screens, the ambulances will see the same thing on their screens. So whatever information that we need to give to them, they can automatically see it. And also that helps us when it comes to keeping without violating HIPAA laws. Right. So they can automatically see the information, and that information does not go over the air.
Okay. Any more questions?
Madam Chair,
The fund balance in our 911 fund right now is about $300,000. Okay. So this will leave us a fund balance of about $260,000. The House bill allowed us to use up to half, but we didn't need to use $200,000 at this time.
Okay.
What are you allowed to use that for? Obviously, the equipment, but any personnel or?
No personnel, but this was a special provision since there were a lot of counties that had large fund balances and a lot of needs with respect to communications, right, to allow them a little bit of flexibility to use it for other than just dispatch equipment. So that's why we're asking to use that now.
But it can be used to buy a vehicle, for instance. Can you do that?
You could under this House bill, but not normally. This is kind of a special exception.
Any more questions? Not, do I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment?
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor,
second,
say aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Opposed? All right. Thank you. Okay. Next is budget amendments 33, 34, and 35 for the Health Department. There.
Commissioners, thank you all for this opportunity to share that we've got some more funding that's come our way. You'll be so inclined to accept it for us. The first one is budget amendment number 33, which is an aid to county allotment that we've gotten from the state for $40,938. And as you can see, where the expenditures will be going for operations, and we're going to be using this all to support supplies and things that we need in our department. We've been receiving these funds the past few years, but with the state budget being like it is, we didn't know if we were going to be able to get it this year or not. So we indeed have received the funding, and so we propose to use it for these items as shown below.
Okay. Do we want to do these one at a time?
That'll be fine.
All in favor of this budget amendment, please make a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Second. A motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
The next item, which is amendment number 34. We actually got additional funding from the state WIC program, which was $19,896.02 above what we'd anticipated at the time the budget was approved. These funds became available because of our caseload and patient participation. So we're asking that we use these as we go into our personnel costs in the WIC program.
Okay. Any questions on this? If not, do I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment?
Second.
Have a motion and get a second.
Second.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay. It passes. Next is budget amendment number 35.
And this is a mini grant that we received again from the state WIC program to promote our breastfeeding initiative. And we will be using this in order to make more time available for the ladies who we've hired as our breastfeeding coordinators to work with our patients to promote breastfeeding amongst our patients.
Okay. Any questions, Mr.
Vance? What are the numbers on WIC now as far as percentile? year-to-date increase or decrease, or is it just stable? Or?
It's been fairly stable, yes, sir. Our caseload, as a matter of fact, is currently we have an assigned caseload of 4,517, and as of last month, it was 4,521. So we're staying pretty much within that number, yes, sir.
Any more questions? If not, do I hear a motion to accept this budget amendment? Has a motion and a second on Thursday. Say aye.
Aye.
And if I may take just a 30-second liberty, please, Mayor, I just want to share with the board that Michelle Herbeck, who is our WIC director, has been nominated to be the president-elect of the State WIC Directors Association of North Carolina.
Right.
So I want to commend Michelle for that honor, and I want to share with you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank appreciate you. It.
Okay, next we have the county manager report.
I have nothing to say.
You're a kid.
Miracles will never cease.
Well,
not a thing.
Not a thing. Okay, then we'll move right along to the consent agenda. Does anybody have anything they want to pull from that?
I had just one correction on last month's minutes there, just a minor detail on the last vote of our consent agenda.
Okay.
Which was the resolution on the prayer. It says I made the motion and seconded it. So. Actually, I made the motion. Ms. Vaughn seconded that motion.
Oh, okay.
Minor detail there.
Okay.
And correction.
Okay. If not, other than that, do I hear a motion with that change? Do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
Second.
Have a motion?
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So that's the consent agenda. The next is commissioner's comments. And I was open floor for commissioner's comments.
I'm like Craig. I don't have any tonight.
Ms. Sutton?
You do?
Sure.
Go ahead.
I'll
I might want to respond to you. Go ahead.
Entertain us.
Well, Mr. Kim Oliver wanted me to comment. Not sure. I have all your questions, but let me just put it this way to you, Kim. Kim, was it a couple of years ago that you asked to meet with the commissioners? And if I remember correctly, I may be wrong. Sometimes I can't remember yesterday. Mr. Sutton and I met with you, and I believe Clyde Albright was also in there, and that was quite a discussion going on in the back room. Is that correct?
That's exactly right.
But you were a citizen and asked to meet with the mayor.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right.
After the meeting last time, Mr. Onfalka asked me if I'd like to go for a cup of coffee. I'm always ready to go for a cup of coffee.
Right.
Okay. Went down there. I had one cup of coffee. The discussion had nothing to do with what occurred in this this classroom. Excuse me. In some things carry over in this room. Right. Nothing was said about Fairness Alamance or what was said in this room. Talked about other issues. Okay, he is a citizen.
Right.
Why shouldn't I go and have a cup of coffee? No pie, nothing else, a cup of coffee. And we came out, and you gentlemen were gone from in front of the building when we came out. So you didn't stay there very long. I don't know why we're making an issue out of it.
May I speak, please? You missed my question.
Well, you brought him into it, so.
You missed my question.
Well, he brought me into it.
I know. I understand, you know, and that's fine.
Since the ACLU's been here, hammering our sheriff's department and our deputies and the DOJ, you have broke ranks time and time again with the other commissioners on the board and not supported them without nothing more than accusations, no proof whatsoever of any wrongdoing. And the fact that the last meeting, Mr. Onsbacher stood at that podium for 3 solid minutes and viciously attacked all 5 of you commissioners over misconduct and claims of a cover-up from not only the commissioners but the sheriff's department and the deputies. And then 45 minutes later, you're going to have tea or coffee with him up the sidewalk? That just doesn't look good in a citizen's eyes.
Ms. Vaughn,
may I
speak?
Well, if she brings you into it and...
It's a matter of clarification for a statement she made.
I'll let Ms. Vaughn make that decision.
Sure. At your leisure.
Sure.
As I recall, the meeting you just referenced was at my request. Mr. Oliver joined me in that meeting, and Mr.
I remember, Albright, I remember Mr. Oliver.
Mr. Albright was also present because it was county business, as was Mr. Sutton, and I think that's the point he's trying to make, was that was a public meeting, public officials on public time and public property, and I don't want this cloud to remain that you're trying to embellish. That's two different situations in his defense. Thank you.
Do you remember any of those? And just a second, Eddie, if you don't mind.
I'm going to let them speak if they want to speak.
Your request was with the commissioners. Two of us responded. And as a commissioner, I felt that I should. I can't speak for Mr. Sutton, but he was also there, too. So anytime a commissioner calls me on the phone, I don't necessarily agree with what they say, but I'm going to be respectful.
I personally understand your response. I spoke to clarification on it.
Okay. Next.
Eddie.
It's up to Ms. Vaughn at this point.
On this subject, I fail to see what is anybody's business, who y'all talk to once you leave this room. I don't know where this is coming from. If you speak to me on the street, which every one of you do, or you would stop by the house, which any one of you is welcome to, I don't see that's none of these people's business. I'd like y'all to tell them to shut it.
Thank you.
Well, that's pretty much enough. But you got some nicely more. Put. Oh, yes, I've got some more. Did you want to jump in here?
No, I'm fine. Go ahead.
Now, when you bring these people in now, we'll let them speak, okay?
Sure. I'm not going to bring them in.
Otherwise, they don't. Okay. Now, you got more than 3 minutes. When you bring them into the conversation, then... Is that not right, Mr. Albright?
Hello.
When she brings them into the conversation.
Depends on what policy you adopt. You don't have one right now.
We don't have one. Yes, exactly right.
We have no
she
policy.
She asked them a question.
Really, it's up to the
Well, chair. I did ask the question, and, you know, that's fine.
If that's what she wants, I'm fine with it.
All right.
I came across some information very recently, and this has to do with Mr. Steve Bowman. There's a picture of him. He is from Alamance County, and I would like to read the information I have on this gentleman. 8 outstanding industry leaders have been inducted into the International Towing and Recovery Hall of Fame as the class of 2010. These were nominated for their many contributions to the towing and recovering industry, their families, and their communities. Local businessman Steve M. Bowman, with Battleground Tire and Record Service, was one of the individuals to receive international recognition at this year's events. Each year, the International Towing and Recovery Hall of Fame and Museum recognizes a prestigious group of individuals represented from across the globe who have made substantial and significant contributions to the towing and recovery industry. To honor those chosen few, an entire section of the museum's walls are dedicated for portraits of the inductees. This is the highest honor available to members of the towing industry. I could go ahead and read all else that he's been involved in, all that he's done. I'm not going to because y'all are squirming and want to leave, but I do want to say he currently serves as a TRPNC Legislative Committee, TRPNC Board of Directors, State Director for North Carolina to the TRAA, and is a board member of the North Carolina Executive Committee for Highway Safety. And a big congratulations, and I did want to bring that to your attention here. Big congratulations to Mr. Bowman.
You got more?
Oh, do I ever? Yes, I have more.
Go ahead.
Don't you want to take your turn?
No, I'm about to just relax.
Getting ready.
Yes. No.
I'm all right.
Okay. I want to do the nice first. And then I'll do the why I got upset this weekend in response to a memo. Weekly update on 9/27/10 to 10/1/20.
The request concerning lawsuits was not focused on the Sheriff's Department. This is what was in the memo. The dilatory tactic, since it was mishandled twice, may lead one to believe that it was on purpose. And I choose to read this because evidently we're having trouble understanding. It has been 6 weeks since the request was made for information that has not been forthcoming. According to GS 132-1 and 132-1.3, titled Settlements Made by or on behalf of public agencies, public officials, or public employees, public records. Maybe if it is in writing, one may get it right. Number one, all past, and I asked for 4 years, and present lawsuits, administrative proceedings, or arbitrations instituted against any agency of Alamance County or its subdivisions. Number two, for those lawsuits, administrative proceedings, or arbitrations that have been settled, all settlement documents included but not limited to correspondence, settlement agreements, consent orders, checks, and bank drafts. Since 6 weeks have already passed, I don't believe that it would be unreasonable to expect this information in the weekly packet on October 9th, 2010. Thank you. And I don't know if you folks want a copy of this down front.
Who are you addressing this to?
Well, it came out in the memo.
And I do apologize that I misunderstood, and Clyde and I will get together and make sure we get you the information. And I do apologize if I got the wrong information.
Well, what is this one?
I don't know.
We're looking at past lawsuits that were with Alamance County employees over the past 5 years.
Well,
it was our fault that we focused solely on the Sheriff's Department where we should have looked at all.
So your request was inclusive of all of the departments.
Right, and we were wrong on how we presented the information.
Any agency of Alamance County or its subdivision.
And I do apologize for the clarification that was not.
Yeah. I think it's important to note, though, that all counties, all municipalities are sued for various reasons, and most go unsettled or whatever. I wouldn't mind knowing some details on that, but I would like to know some explanation at that time, if you can't give it tonight, is when do we choose to use an attorney outside of your office? I mean, I'm seeing one set of attorney fees here that are staggering for a case that I would have thought, I mean, is it that, I mean, at what point do you go outside versus inside?
It depends on what agency the suit's brought against. If it's the sheriff's office, the bonding company defends. If it's EMS, we usually have insurance that pays for those expenses.
So those expenses really don't come back to the county. Is that what you're
The insurance saying? Company pays for them, and then the next year our premiums reflect our experience. That's generally the way it works.
Okay. So, as a fiduciary of the county coffers, I think it's important that we are kept abreast of this kind of information. I don't know that in the 4 years I've been here, it's ever been mentioned.
Well, there's not been a list kept. I had to compile that list, but I will expand it now that I know I need to expand it.
Yeah, we definitely need to know that.
Yeah, okay.
We don't need, in my opinion, we do not need to give in to lawsuits. We need to fight them. And if they're sued in the county, we do not need to go along with them just to get along.
Okay, the second issue I wanted to bring up has to do with county policy. And according to the April 29th edition of the weekly paper, the hire date and longevity pay was posted for many county employees. I noted six, and that could have been more, employees that had a hire date of 3 years or less and received longevity pay ranging anywhere from 2.5% to 6%. And as I read the personnel policy book, you have to be employed for 5 years before you get longevity pay, and that would be at 2.5%, and it increased from there. You can tell I wasn't real happy when I started doing my typing, especially from the other one and then going to this one. Is it the practice of county government to give an employee hired in June an automatic pay raise when that does occur? Or a COLA because they are on the payroll the first day of the fiscal year? Should a new hire receive the same benefits as an employee that has been employed for a year or years? Also, is it the practice of county government to give longevity pay to an employee because they are on the payroll on the first day of December? I find it physically irresponsible to employees who work for the county for a year or more to reward new hires with these benefits. Is it fair to those employees that have been here for a year or years? Are we treating our personnel policy as a set of rules, or are they just guidelines to be disregarded at will? We have a published policy manual that must be followed by everyone. Just trash it.
Well, on longevity pay, I don't know. You weren't personnel. You weren't county manager, but I do remember that we went in and analyzed it years ago, and I'm talking about years ago. It could have been a decade ago. And we were paying out roughly, best of my memory, $500,000 or something like that in longevity pay, and if not more. And I thought at that time we structured it to where it wasn't as easy to get it, and we changed at what level you got it. You had to be here longer to get it and so forth. So now, I don't know what the rules are.
I think it's 20 years now.
I know we changed it.
It's 6%. So it increases over. It's 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. Is that right?
It's 5 years. It's 2.5%, and then it increases at 10 years, and I can't remember what the next increments are.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what you're referring to right there. I'd be glad to look into it, though.
Right.
The policy is 2.5%.
We can look at the individual ones that look like they do not meet policy and give
I've
you
got that at home
explanations of why it's not meeting policy.
Okay. I can't do it tomorrow. My day starts at 7 and I may get home by 7:30 tomorrow night. That's the way it works.
No problem.
Okay, but possibly the next day. Okay. I did receive a call, and somebody had gotten on the blogs under Tim Sutton's name and used Tim Sutton's name, and I hate to think it was, in fact, Tim Sutton. I honestly believe it was not.
What was it?
It had to do, using your name, that Virginia Lands Microsoft Data Center and the part that I have a problem with, and evidently the caller did too, referred to by Boyer's style. He has an obvious agenda to hurt those in office who are conservative. I will say it loud and clear here, as I have told it to him to his face. He is a yellow journalist, which is worse than being a prostitute. That, Tim, I don't believe you would say anything like that or put it on the blogs.
All right, wait a minute. Yeah, I did that.
And I say I agree with him.
Not only did
but
I do
folks,
it,
that hold is on.
Not only did I, no, it's not either. There were no slanderous comments in there. I've called him a yellow journalist right here. But I put in my cell phone number, so yes, me.
Well, you as an elected official, Tim. Yeah, you put your phone number on here too. Mm-hmm. You as elected official, I'm going to disagree with you doing that, but of course you're free to do what you want. I just think you should be above.
Well, what did I do you don't like?
Let me say what I think is a yellow
journalist. Wait. I don't want
okay.
to vote here. Let her finish. Ms. Vaughn has the floor.
All right, here's what took place. Mac Williams called me, and I guess this is about the article about where they were insinuating that, you know, Tim Sutton had to do with losing the deal. And Mac told me that he felt like he was led into talking about me. Now, I was hot when I saw the bait and switch. I mean, you know, I knew what was going on. I'm not ashamed of that. I'll write it again if it happens again. So,
she's still doing her commission.
Let me ask Clyde.
I can wait.
As an attorney.
Let's get it wrong. Let's keep it on.
Is it wise?
Don't say that.
Is it wise for a commissioner to go on the blogs under that name and put things like this?
Let me just
no,
say.
No, I asked him a question.
Well, ask him and let me have it. I'm tired of being quiet. I'm ready to roll. Let's go.
I'm ready to go home and let them.
I don't want to have to gather down right
now. She get me fired up now.
I'm just asking
well,
from a legal point of view.
Well, this is supposed to be commissioner's okay. comments.
I'm
not,
just asking for
not a public okay. debate right here, I'm telling you.
I don't have a legal opinion on that issue.
Okay. This is supposed to be just commissioner comments, but you're bringing people in on it.
Please. And if I were you, I'd just worry about what Ann Vaughn does, and don't worry about what Tim Sutton does.
Okay.
Are you through, Wayne?
I'm through.
Okay. You're
through.
Okay. Yeah. Just in jest, I've enjoyed the exchange. I've enjoyed being able to talk now. If we can address public comments at the podium there to where we can talk right afterwards, I think that would be a dynamite thing to do, and I'll support that 100%. You know, in all honesty, I went back and watched the DVD of the last meeting, and I wasn't real proud of myself. I'm not going to lie to you. And, but I explained why I did that. Does it justify it? No. But I did apologize. And I think this will remedy the situation if we can have him talk and then us talk afterwards. To show you how concerned I was about it, I was sitting in my car. I was trying to leave. And people kept coming up. This guy put his hand through my window. I rolled my passenger side window down. He put his hand, he about fell in my car trying to shake my hand. And he was saying, you know, keep doing what you're doing. Don't get discouraged, blah, blah, blah. And then we started talking about stock car racing, and it's something I enjoy. And so this woman walked by. You remember the woman that sat there with two children? Had a little boy and had a little girl holding a little stuffed animal. And they were walking by, and I looked at him, the guy that was standing beside me, as they walked by my car in front. I said, do you know why they were there? Do you have any idea? And he said, no. And I said, he said, no. And I said, well, you know, I need to talk to them. If you'll excuse me, I need to say something to them. And he hollered at her to stop. He said, Mr. Sutton will speak to y'all. So I got out, and I shook her hand, and I said, I am sorry that your children had to witness that little outburst of mine or that raising of my voice is I said, you don't know what's been going on with this situation. And I said, I am sorry that your children had to witness this. And I feel bad about it. She said, oh, don't worry about it. She said, you did the right thing. I think she was talking about I did the right thing in apologizing, to be perfectly honest about it. The little boy was here for his Boy Scout. He had to attend a Boy Scout. To be a Boy Scout, whatever the rank was, he had to come to a civic meeting. And a little girl, I shook her hand, I shook the little boy's hand, little girl's hand, and mama's hand, and I said, I am so sorry. So I didn't take it very lightly. I don't. I will say this, though. You know, our country is founded on passion, decorum at times when we have to do the best we can. But here was it was so apropos that this was in the Raleigh News Observer the Sunday after that meeting. And it was talking about which founders for the Tea Party. And it's got George Washington in there, Jefferson, I think Hamilton, I'm not sure. But it just says in this article, without reading, I was going to read it, that if you think that the founding fathers sat around and said constantly, my honorable colleague, and that it just didn't happen. And so I think there is a time for passion and there's a time for reining it in. And I am going to try to rein it in. And but I'm very passionate about the issue. And when people stand in front of me and tell me that what I said was what the tape does not show that I said, and then even agreed to it the next meeting, and then tries to get into defining what a word means in the thesaurus, which, by the way, was the definition of the noun word use of challenge versus the verb, you know, I have to respond. And to wait an hour after the fact, it takes it all out of context. And so if we can work it out where everybody can speak and throw the barbs out there, but give us, you know, a few minutes later, we're going to get our shot, I'm all for that. And
I don't know what else to say other than, you know, I've been sitting here for a good while, and this may be my last go around, and it may not be. But I think the people that have come to that podium over 15 years, that I've been very respectful, basically. And sure, I let it overflow the other night, but I don't think we need to really change, try to recreate the wheel because of that. But I do think it'd be in a good direction to do what we're doing, like speak right after they speak. And if they speak at the end and we speak right behind them, that I can be quiet for a minute or two. But I didn't take it lightly last week, and I don't want anybody to think that I'm that arrogant or that I'm that. I mean, I've been blasted on the blogs, too, for, you know, more than I think I deserve the credit for. But, you know, it's we live in a great country, but we didn't get it to be as great as it is as a result of people being too soft to speak out or show passion. And, you know, it goes all the way back to our founding fathers, like the gentleman was standing right here saying tonight, you know, it's what would Thomas Jefferson say? What would some of our founding fathers say? So, you know, I'll try to be more of a diplomat, but, you know, my emotion, I hope, never leaves me, because it's like I used to tell my wife, you know, when, you know, the day that I quit getting fired up about issues is I guess I no longer care about them. And so I'm going to always have to speak out. And I apologize if it does rub some people wrong, but I think we got a good solution here, and so I'll let it play out.
Okay. Is that it?
Okay. Well, let me say the reason I say Bob Boyers is a Yale journalist is a couple of weeks ago when he labeled me as a running for re-election and a county commissioner running for re-election, and he said Mr. David Blair was a citizen down here for himself, which is not the case. He is a spokesperson for Fairness Alamance, and you knew it. And nobody in the county knows it, but I hope they know it now. So that's why I say, you say what a reporter's supposed to tell the facts, that's so the people that are not at this meeting know what's going on. They're not supposed to understand and comprehend what you want them to know and your philosophy of government. You know, I realize that you're a liberal, and I can accept that, and I consider you a friend of mine. But you are a Yala journalist.
I don't even know what to do. Mr. Boss?
No, I can't follow that.
And I don't have anything either.
And everybody speaks for themselves. Okay.
So,
announcements.
This worked out fine tonight. So, any announcements anywhere? If not, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners' Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners' Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.